video interview I had done in 2008 with the former editor of the Jakarta Post, Robert S. Finnegan. Fascinating interview. Hope you enjoy this one just as much as you enjoyed my last one.
Yeah, you wanted to ask me a few questions?
Yeah, can you tell us what's been happening as far as your escape from America and getting your visa in Indonesia? Has there been any developments there, Mr. Robert S. Finnegan?
The only developments that I've had is that I'm being stonewalled by the Indonesian government regarding my visa. I entered Indonesia in February, and up to this point, with or without the collusion of the American government, I've been denied, up to this point, my visa to stay here in Indonesia, despite the fact that I worked for the Indonesian government, unpaid, as the international communications editor for the Coordinated Ministry of the Economy, Dr. Jatin, under Mahendra Sirigar. And I think this has something to do with it. I believe firmly that the American government, even though Ralph Boyce has been disgraced and deposed, Ralph Boyce was the ambassador at the time of the Bali bombings, and he was my number one nemesis. Ralph Boyce thought that I was determined to undermine American interests in Indonesia, and Ralph Boyce was responsible, solely responsible, for my firing and my ejection from Indonesia in 2003.
How can you say that he was solely responsible? Do you know that for a fact?
Yes. He met twice with my publisher and my chief editor, the publisher being Sabam Segyan, and my chief editor being Raymond Turan. And he, at both meetings, he demanded my firing and my ejection, and he accomplished it.
Did you have some evidence on what happened at Bali that maybe Ralph Boyce might have thought was a bit embarrassing to be exposed?
Yes. I developed, I and my team developed CIA Mossad involvement in the Bali bombing of 2002 at Kuta. And this is why Ralph Boyce made a concerted effort to silence me.
That's amazing. Did you get any flack for this discovery when you found out that CIA were involved? Did you get any kind of flack from anybody else apart from Ralph Boyce?
Well, it wasn't flack, but before my analysis was published on January, I believe it was January 3rd, 2003, about 2 months after the bombing, and I vetted my analysis through my chief editor, Raymond Turan, and through my publisher, Sabam Segyan, and they both told me at the time, "Do you realize, Mr. Finn," and I use quote marks, "do you realize what this could do to the Jakarta Post?" And I said, "Yes." And I offered both of them to kill the story. If they thought that it was so destructive that it could mean the end of the Jakarta Post, I offered to go ahead and kill the story. And they said, "No, we're committed." Sabam Segyan, the publisher of the Jakarta Post, told me personally, in these words, "We are committed. So we're going to go ahead with this." And they signed off, both of them signed off on my special report on the Bali bombing that was published in January 2003.
Well, what was the general mood of the people when the Australians moved in? Was there a kind of a lot of defiance? Was there an air of, my God, is this possible?
It was fear. It was complete and total fear. Because they moved in, and you know, the so-called international investigating team, you know, which was comprised of Australian FBI and God knows how many other intelligence organizations, because at that time CUDA was crawling with spooks. It was crawling with spooks. And the thing that was so striking that struck me was, at the time, I was wondering how so many intelligence operatives from so many different agencies all over the world were in, just so happened to be at CUDA at that time. I mean, it's physically impossible for them to jump on the plane when they heard about the bombing and be there, because I was there in the morning after the bombing, and I'm already running into DGSC guys from France, from French intelligence. What are they doing there? What are they doing there? How in the hell did a group of individuals manage to penetrate Sangla Hospital and remove five bodies of soldiers that are attached to the UN on East Timor and fly them out of a closed airport at Denpasar? How does that happen? You know, and that's when Damaso Reyes went in and got the flight logs and the apron logs, and they had both been altered. You know, these guys thought they were smart, they thought they were really funny, and they went ahead and they altered the tower logs, but Damaso was one step ahead of them. He went down onto the apron because Damaso knew that there were two sets of logs, not one, two. So he got the tower logs, he got the copies of the tower logs, and then he went down onto the apron, and he got the apron locks, and that's where we found out that these people had gone ahead and altered the logs on this flight that went out. And, by the way, the plane that flew out these bodies was Israeli registered. We lost it in Singapore. When the Singaporean authorities refused to cooperate with us, we lost it there. But it was a Conair-7, okay? I mean, everything fitted. Yeah, they could put five bodies on there. They did it. And they flew it into Singapore to refuel, and that's why we lost it.
How soon after the bombings did you get a phone call from Joe Viles, the West Australian researcher?
Joe Viles saw my publication of my special report on the bombing in the Jakarta Post in January of 2003, and that's when we established our contact.
January.
So it was about 2000.
Right.
Yeah.
And what was Joe's contention? What did he feel actually had happened at the Bali bombings?
Well, as a matter of fact, Joe is an expert in aircraft identification. So before I talked to Joe, I had no idea that the plane that flew these bodies out was in fact a Conair-7. Joe Viles got the identification on the aircraft for us. And Joe's dead. I still don't know what happened to Joe. I have no idea what happened to him. But he died suddenly.
That's right.
In
July of 2005, he died of a sudden massive heart attack, according
to
sources.
No. They told me that Joe died from a kidney, adrenal problem.
Right.
That's what they told me. Not a heart attack.
Okay.
So...
What was his contention primarily about what the blast was composed of?
Micro-nuke.
Did you believe that at first?
No. I did not.
What did it take? What was the pivotal moment that you suddenly realized that, oh my God, maybe Joe was right? When was it, that pivotal moment?
At the time... We were working, our team was working, you know, like 16, 18-hour days. And I was very, you know, very tired, very upset because I had a language deficiency, you know, Bahasa Indonesia and English. And so I was dependent upon my students to do all the interviewing. So prior to them going out and interviewing people, I had to brief them on security issues. And that was my number one concern, was that, you know, I mean, we're talking about, you know, 20-year-old kids, journalism students, that are taking this something like this of this magnitude on. And so you can imagine I had, you know, many, many sleepless nights worrying about their safety. So basically they were my eyes and ears on the ground. And they were doing, you know, this entire investigation up to that point was done by them, not by me. And so, when Joe Biles, he originally faxed me an inquiry to Jakarta Post, and he brought up the micro-nuke theory, and I was angry. When my student handed this to me, I crumpled it up and I threw it in the trash can, and I told her, you know, go back to work. This is garbage. There's nothing to this. Go back to work and deal with the realities of this case. And right about that time, I got back my photos from Sangla Hospital. you know. I was grasping at straws. I was grasping at straws because I knew, having walked the site, that this was not conventional explosive. I knew it. But for me to say that, people look at me and they're going, look at this nutcase. Yeah, he thinks it's a micro-nuke. Okay, so to make a long story short, when Joe sent me the facts, I crumpled it up and threw it in the trash can. And at that time, I got the film back from Sangla Hospital showing an individual that was purportedly at first to be Peter Hughes, and it turned out he wasn't, on the Indonesian ward, sporting flash burns. And I couldn't put it together. When I first saw the images, I just, you know, I threw them into a pile and I thought, okay, that's that. And then after I chewed out my students for giving me Joe Viles' facts, suggesting that it might have been a micronuclear device in CUDA, they pulled out the photo of this individual that I'd taken in Sangla Hospital burn ward. And they came back to me, and they were really timid, you know, because I'm not the easiest guy in the world to work for. And, you know, they put it in front of me, and they said, okay, Father, what's wrong with this? And I looked at it, and I said, what do you mean? What, you know, the guy's burned, okay? He's burned. And And Sari said, "Yeah, but Father, look at the burns on his face." You know, and I go, "Okay, yeah, he's burned. Okay, yeah, sure, he's burned. But he has his hair." And I looked at the photo, and that's when the whole thing came together. You know, this guy's got second and third degree burns on his face. I really started studying the photo. And where his t-shirt was, his chest and torso were completely clear. But below where his t-shirt was on his arms, he had second and third degree burns. And around his neck, where the t-shirt was, he had second and third degree burns on his face, all the way up to his hair, and he still had his hair. And, you know, I sent this to Marine Corps EOD, and they looked at it and they said, "Yeah, no, this guy, what the hell is this? You know, what is this?" And you know, I told them, I go, "I don't know. You guys are supposed to tell me." And they said, "Well, we can't account for these burns. We can't account for these burns." That was what they sent me in a letter. "We cannot account for these burns." And that was Marine Corps, United States Marine Corps Explosive Ordnance Division. They couldn't account for them. They'd never seen them before, you know. And I interviewed a couple of doctors at Sangla from Australia that had shown up. They were there on vacation. And they'd shown up. And these guys were terrified. They were terrified. They didn't want to talk to me. They didn't want to say anything about any burns. No burns. No, we don't talk about burns. We don't talk about that. No. We talk about casualties. You know? I'm going, "Okay. But why won't you talk about the burns?" And they walked away from me. They were terrified. There was actually one Australian doctor that told me, "I've never seen anything like this, except in pictures that I've seen taken in the aftermath of Hiroshima and Nagasaki."
Thanks very much for coming on and talking to us here. And I can't wait for your latest release and whatever it is when it comes out on SoutheastAsianNews.org. Thanks very much, Rob.
Thank you, Steve.